What's up, everybody? We are here at the AfterBuzz studio to interview the one and only Van Johnson from 9mag. Very exclusive interview. You won't want to miss it. Tune in.
You're tuning into the destination for TV superfan discussion, AfterBuzz TV. And now, let the buzz begin.
You want to fuck with a nigga from the Chi-town.
Shout out to Four.
Hey.
What's up, Four? What up, Chi-town?
It's a Black Ink Chicago celebration.
Yes, it is. What's up, everybody? I'm your girl, Carmen Cameron. You can find me on Instagram at Carmen Cameron.
Oh, me. Hey, yeah. Guys. I'm just so excited. I'm your girl, Nakia Monet, and you can find me on all social media at Kiki Boom Boom. And if you guys have any questions for Van, I am in the live chat, so yes. Hit us up, and I'll ask them.
So normally, we're here to discuss Black Ink Crew Chicago, but today we have a very, very, very special guest with us today, the one and only Mr. Van Johnson from 9mag. Welcome, man.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Thank you so much for being here.
No doubt.
Whew, it's a lot going on. This season, honey.
Yeah, it is.
It is a lot going on.
Y'all ain't seen nothing yet.
Oh, man. Okay, listen. I get scared because we just watched the third episode.
Yes.
And my heart is just like, y'all give me anxiety.
Yes. It's good. You guys are making it great, though.
It's an amazing show.
You know, but before we get into the drama, we really want to make this about you, and we want to find out more about you. Mm-hmm. So we know that you're from Chicago.
Yeah, born and raised.
Can you tell us what it's like growing up on the south side of Chicago?
First of all, it was really tough growing up on the south side of Chicago. A lot of drugs, you know, a lot of gun violence, a lot of murders. So it's really pretty much you just got to know exactly, you know, how to move out in Chicago.
Exactly.
Know where to go, who to be around. Those kids out there just don't have any guidance, you know, so they're just looking for, you know, they're looking for some help.
Yeah, it's portrayed in the media that it's a really dangerous place. So,
it is.
You know, coming from that type of street life, what made you take that upbringing and want to transition into being a tattoo artist?
I had seen so many struggles, you know what I'm saying, over the course of my, you know, 34 years of living, especially when I was younger. After high school, I started, you know, getting into a lot of garbage as far as, you know, burglaries and stuff like that. That transitioned over to me to go and have some jail time in DeKalb, Illinois, which is a Northern University out there around DeKalb. And after that, I just seen that that wasn't really the lifestyle that I wanted to, you know, portray for me and my child.
Right.
I didn't want to have to live, you know, through any suffering like that. So
right.
I wanted to do something that was more positive and that was going to, you know, make me have future wealth.
Right.
In terms of that, I didn't want to work a 9-to-5 for the rest of my life. Right. And I couldn't even get one, you know what I'm saying, because I was already a felon. So I was designing clothes and shoes back then.
All right.
And
so that, you're a designer originally,
yeah,
first.
Yeah, I was a designer.
That's what's up.
Yeah. And that led me into, you know, being able to see what kind of revenue I can generate with my hands.
Yes.
And then I met a close friend of mine, a mentor by the name of D.
Mm-hmm.
He the one who had actually gave me my first tattoo machine and my first power supply to start my career off.
Nice.
And he pretty much gave me my jump into, you know, into tattooing.
Help you transition from that street life.
Yeah, definitely.
Nice. Being that I'm a huge hip-hop fan, and I feel like you're from Chicago, the mecca of hip-hop, where some of the greatest rappers have come out of. Is there anybody from Chicago that inspired you when you were coming up? Any music that you were listening to growing up?
Growing up, I listened to a lot of Common, listened to a lot of Kanye West, of course. Other inspirations was like DMX.
Nice.
Jay-Z has always been a huge inspiration.
Always.
You know, so.
Definitely.
That's what's up.
Now, we know that one of your mottos and even your tattoos read it, family first. This
exactly.
is a huge thing for Van. And condolences, because we just recently found out that you lost your uncle, and I can definitely relate to the struggle behind that, losing a family member and having to stay focused on work and all of that type of thing. Do you feel, and you also mentioned that you lost your father early and that your uncle was the person who took his place and kind of guided you in your childhood.
That's true.
Do you feel that the loss of your father is what made you kind of step up and become this protective, almost like you had to fill his shoes? And that kind of, because we've heard Charmaine mention that, you know, Van's like the daddy, Van's like the papa.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think that kind of gave you the papa bear persona, filling those shoes?
Honestly, it's probably because I'm the oldest in the shop, you know, and I'm 34. All the rest of the cast is, you know, younger than I am. I think Ryan is 30, just made 31.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I was older than everybody, and when I came in, I always had the mature mindset of being, you know, a leader.
Right.
And those guys kind of gravitated towards me. Plus, I'm the glue of the shop. If somebody's having an issue in that shop, you know, they can come talk to me about it, and I'm the one to try to alleviate the situation, kind of reconcile the differences.
Right. I want to touch back on that point that you just made, but to backtrack a little, can you tell us how you and Ryan became friends?
Yeah, we actually just did an interview for the Chicago Defender. It's one of the, you know, the hugest black owned newspapers in Chicago.
Nice. And
we actually became good friends over tattoos because I was the inspiration for Ryan to start tattooing.
Nice. Yeah, okay.
So I was only tattooing for maybe about a month or two.
Okay.
And I went to this barbershop that everybody was getting tattoos done at, and you know, I set up my equipment, and I stayed at that barbershop for about 3 weeks, 4 weeks, tattooing every single day. And Ryan had just lost his job.
Okay.
He was looking for, you know, another source of income, and you know, I was his inspiration to, you know, trying to pick up that needle. And then his sister Nova, you know, bought him his first tattoo, you know, his first tattoo equipment.
Nice.
That's very insightful for us because it kind of answers a little bit of questions with the family aspect. Right. Knowing that you are a part of his development, people that you tend to develop, they in your mind, they do become family, and you do feel like you're a part of their artistry in a way when you inspire them.
Right. I was going to ask, because family and loyalty is very important to you.
Yes.
And I was going to say, tell us why that is.
Yes.
Well, family and loyalty is important for me because I've lost so many loved ones in my life. You know, from my father, my mom has always been the backbone of our family, from losing her mother, which is my grandmother, and my aunt. Mm-hmm. You know, I just had so many losses over the course of my lifespan to let me know that, you know, family is everything. And if you lose someone, you know, it's really, really tough to kind of bounce back from that.
It is.
And I just don't want to, you know, fall by the wayside with these guys who we've already accumulated to have this great show and this big platform.
Yes.
And to move as, you know, as diligent as we have since season one until now to get to the level that we are, and then just start tearing apart, you know.
And that's what we're seeing happening. And we're watching the show, and we know that you guys have this strong family bond amongst each other. And we have a lot of questions about what's going on with the dynamic. Now, you mentioned before you're the oldest person in the shop.
Yes.
And I even have a quote here from Ryan, I apologize, saying, Van is the oldest from the crew, and he's able to look at things from a more experienced mindset. Mm-hmm. At what point did he stop respecting that about you? Because it's seeming like he's not... acknowledging that you have good common sense.
I think the cameras, you know what I'm saying? When the cameras that came around, I mean, we've always had a tight bond, you know what I'm saying? Me, Ryan, Four, and Kat, we was like the originators of 9Mac.
Mm-hmm.
Now, when we started this business, that's exactly what it was. You know, it wasn't any overheads. You know, Ryan did have the name, LLC. That generated after we got the show, because the shop has always been named 9Mac, you understand?
So you guys were friends.
We was definitely friends.
Came together and said, let's start a shop together.
Right.
So there was no owner, per se. There was no one person ahead. So at what point did Ryan become the owner? Because 9Mac belongs to Ryan, correct?
The name belongs to Ryan, the LLC.
Right.
So Ryan can take that name and go open up another shop.
Okay. Gotcha.
This shop that we have currently, you know, I don't pay Ryan, never have paid Ryan.
And
you know what I'm saying?
That makes a lot of sense. Because we were a little confused because we're like, you know, throughout the season, it's been a group collective.
It's always been that.
Yeah. And we're seeing. I do have a question. Now that you guys are on the reality show, I think you guys are on season three. Do you ever look back and say, you know what, I kind of wish that these cameras were not here? Is there one thing that you would change about this whole reality experience?
Well, in terms of doing a reality television show, I was always thinking that was going to be real, you know? And a lot of the things that we shoot, you know, everything that they capture is real life stuff that we actually go through.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the way that they edit and do their own thing over at VH1, I have no control over that. Neither one of us does.
Oh, okay.
So that's what you see is a bunch of edits and clips. You don't even see exactly why I'm going so hard for my team. You understand?
Right.
You don't see why I fight so hard. You don't see why I busted the windows. I'm not delusional.
Right.
I'm not crazy.
Can you tell us the story behind it?
Because we did play Jasmine Sullivan, I bust the windows out your car.
Yeah.
AKA your shop.
Like, what led up to that moment?
Yes.
What was it when you were like, you know what?
Because you had a tough day that day.
Yes.
You found out that your uncle passed away. You know, a lot is on your shoulders.
Right.
And then you go to your shop to be around your family, and the lock is changed.
Yeah, it took me by total surprise.
I would be upset.
Yeah.
Yep.
I would feel disrespected.
And I think that everybody that has any common sense that knows that, you know, how we run this business, mm-hmm. whether it's portrayed a certain type of way on television, mm-hmm. they would have acted the same way I would too. I have I have my personal things, my mm-hmm. personal belongings inside the mm-hmm. shop. I have a key to get inside the shop, and mm-hmm. I've been had the key ever since the door's been open since day one. Mm-hmm. I'm getting ready to come to the shop, and the doors is locked now, and I can't get in.
And that's the thing, because when you work at a salon, right? Let's use mm-hmm. a salon for an example. You pay your booth rent. You have a key, you schedule your clients according to your schedule, mm-hmm. and there is no really owner or no overseer that really tells you what to do, what products to use, what time you have to be there, unless maybe, say, you work for a Vidal Sassoon.
Right.
But that's not how, you already let us know, that's not how Non-Mag came together.
Non-Mag was never, ever ran like that, and I don't think it never will be.
But it's like every 2 seconds, I'm hearing Ryan say, this is my shot.
I said, like, when we...
you don't hear that,
the whole season.
I'm like, is it?
The beginning,
is it really your shot?
The beginning, I was like, you know, what I think Ryan should have done at the beginning when you guys first decided to open this shop mm-hmm. was sit everybody down. Not mm-hmm. just Ryan, but we all sit down and we all distinguish, okay, we're all opening this shop. Mm-hmm. Who's the manager? Who's mm-hmm. this? Because I think now he's like, this is my shop, and I feel like it's a communication problem because everyone's like, actually, we've all started this together.
We all sat down before we started the shop. I'll never forget it. We all had a meeting at Hooters in Chicago.
Let's come through,
Hooters.
We all sat down
and we all, you know, discussed in vivid detail. We said, man, if we're getting ready to start this shop, how are we going to do it? You know, with the steps moving forward. Mm-hmm. He was like, man, I already know you and Four got y'all own thing going on. He's mm-hmm. like, y'all has already been bosses. But mm-hmm. to kind of put this thing together in retrospect to put it out to, you know, an audience of millions or wherever this platform is going to take us, mm-hmm. we know what we can do as a team together.
Yes.
And I said, fine. You know what I'm saying? If we go run this thing like this, then we go open these doors. We go, we go pay a collective booth rent, mm-hmm. and everybody pay that to the owner of the building, mm-hmm. which was NAMAG is in. Mm-hmm. And that was pretty much set in stone. Mm-hmm. Now, once the cameras came, they, you know, kind of wrote their own stories.
That's what I was going to ask you. Do you think that Ryan has an ego problem? Or is he having ego issues because of these cameras? Because it's seeming like he's turning up more and getting a lot more egotistical with the way he's trying to rule and run his company.
Well, I would say everybody is. You know, I'm not going to single anyone out because I've seen over, you know, the course of filming this season and last season how mm-hmm. everybody has kind of like evolved in their own mm-hmm. separate ways. And I'm proud of everybody.
Yes, very.
When we're doing this together, when those cameras leave, we still got to face reality. Mm-hmm. Those cameras are gone right now. Mm-hmm. I'm in that shop every day. Ryan mm-hmm. is in that shop before. You know what I'm saying?
Nice.
So everybody that's
good
there should stay there. And whenever those cameras come back and you got the other people that's come back who has been casted for the show, that means that this should be ran like we started it. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
We should be the overseers for the people who come in. That would make more sense than putting one person up there. That's why you see me going so crazy.
Does that kind of explain how you feel? Because we were trying to figure out what it was that you have against new people. Because you don't tend to like when new people come into the Non-Mag family.
Well, I tend to not like, you know, when people come into the Non-Mag family and try to do things that, you know, we're not accustomed to doing.
Right.
Our shop has always been clean, and we have always had, you know, a certain expectation for our clients when you get into our shop. Mm-hmm. Cobra came in there and lost her damn mind.
No,
yes,
she turned
up. Did. And that was the point. That's how I felt, because watching this past episode, seeing Ryan at the convention and how he welcomed Cobra back after she disrespected the shop. Mm-hmm. She trashed it. She tried to talk stuff and say it wasn't clean.
Exactly.
How can you welcome a person like that back in before you even take the time to work out your issue with your brother, who you've obviously stated he is mature? We know that he has a good his head on his shoulders. Mm-hmm. He's the oldest of the crew. What makes you not? That's why I'm like, Ryan is tripping. He's on some ego shit. It's some ego shit.
I looked at it because I said this last week. I always say what I said. I said that mm-hmm. when we see the episode and the way it's edited, you see her come to the convention and she sits down with him and they have a conversation.
Right.
And then he brings it to the shot, which everyone said it was a little petty. Mm-hmm. But we're talking about the new people. Then we do see mm-hmm. you fighting with Junior.
Yeah.
Can you tell us
Junior?
About?
You
can you tell us
Junior.
About that
you
moment?
Junior's ass.
I was like, oh Lord. Can you tell us about that moment? How did that fight start and what made you guys actually throw blows?
Well, we know what made it start. He came crashing through that window, girl.
So Junior, You know, Ryan didn't tell Junior exactly what was going on from the get go.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Had Junior known. Now Junior's a pretty rational guy. I love Junior, mm-hmm, man. He's cool as hell.
Okay. He's a great artist.
He's a great, a phenomenal artist.
Mm-hmm.
I have no issues with Junior at all. Now the issue that I had when that incident happened was Junior was kind of talking outside of his neck about some things that he didn't know nothing about.
Mm-hmm.
So when he said, first of all, you're disrespecting me when you're saying this is Ryan's shop. This is Ryan's shop. Mm-hmm. Like, no, it's not, motherfucker. It's all our shop. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And if you had known that or took the time to even talk to me about what's going on, I would have told you.
Yeah, because he seems like he's trying to be teacher's pet this season.
Yeah, I mean, and then you see what happens to teacher's pets.
They get beat up.
Van came through. I was like, first Van broke the window, then he lifted up Junior. I'm like, oh no.
Did they put those OJ gloves in your car? You had the gloves.
See, like,
we wanted to know if that was production or if you came ready.
I had just got through changing my girl's tire like maybe
okay,
maybe like a week prior.
Mm-hmm.
So I just had the stuff still in my car.
Right,
because we were all dying.
Was there.
I love that you're like, you know what?
You know
I'm
what?
OJ.
You won't get
but
my print.
Speaking of your girl, there's a great scene where we see you, Jenny, your beautiful daughter, and
yes,
you guys are in the kitchen and you guys mm-hmm are matching and it's adorable. So tell us about your relationship and how long have you guys been together? And when did you guys first meet?
Hey, Jen. Shout out to Jen.
She's great.
Mm-hmm. The guy who taught me how to do tattoos introduced me to Jen.
Nice.
And this is years ago. This had to be when I, like, the start of my career. I've been tattooing for almost 10 years. So mm-hmm I'll say about maybe 9 years back, that's when I met her. And we've been had a, you know, a crazy relationship. It's been off and on, you mm-hmm know, mostly on my behalf.
Oh, but you growing up and getting into
that. You admitted
right
that. That's okay.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Growth.
Yeah. But she's a beautiful girl, you know what I'm saying? Beautiful spirit. And, mm-hmm, you know, the way that she treats my child, you know,
yes, that's
a
very
big
important
deal in my life. You know, and my daughter didn't really even, you know, kind of come on to her at first. You know
right
what I'm saying?
Naturally.
Being able to, you know, open up to her. But that's
good
natural.
That's
and
natural.
I have another question about a shot moment.
Yeah.
Estesita? You know I love
Alicia.
And now that you watch the episode,
sorry,
back,
girl.
Now I think that she talks out the side of her neck a little bit sometimes because she seems very, like, she seems entitled. Like, she felt like her opinion counted more than I thought it did.
I felt like she kind of had to defend herself.
But do you
it
think
was
she deserved what she got last week? Because I felt like a little bit, y'all bullied her a
little
bit.
It was like team
like,
9-9.
You're not 9-9.
It was a bit of a bully moment, but
okay,
it was also, you know, Ryan again mm-hmm putting his, Ryan, if you're out of town,
mm-hmm,
why are you having somebody that's a newcomer come try to tell you how to run
yes
this business?
Yes, that's what I said. There's a pecking order to things, and you shouldn't do that. You shouldn't belittle people like that. And that's why I feel like a lot of the things that he does as a leader is petty.
If you put those guys, like, if you like sending, you know, sending them off to the wolves just
like,
to get eaten.
Yeah.
Like, don't send Alanicia to talk to me about getting into the fucking shop that I've created with you.
Right.
Or don't send Junior to me
to
saying something
you
about, right, you know, like, what's going on. Like, you don't really know what's going on.
I was
on
dying laughing when y'all got on Snap. Like, hey.
Petty.
Like, you know we here. Like, we ain't going nowhere.
But it was like a crew, 9-man crew versus Lil Alanicia. I'm like, Lord, this girl's going to flip out.
Yeah.
But I like that you admitted. You're like, yeah, it kind of was a bully moment.
It was,
you know, ish happens in family. But I did, because we were talking about Jenny, your daughter.
Mm-hmm.
I was on your Instagram and I seen that you were teaching your daughter how to drive.
Yeah, that's true.
Aww.
So your daughter's
true
growing up. How
yes
is that going? Because you have a teenager in your house
yeah
now.
Yeah, she'll be 16 this year.
Oh, the big 1-6.
Yeah. Well, she's been on me about, you know, teaching her how to drive and everything like that. And I've just been like, I'm going to have to rent you a car. You're not going to tear this Benz truck, girl.
No, you got to get a hoopty.
I seen the video. She was like, what do I do? You're like, look where you're going first. So
we always see you with this really cool chain on.
Mm-hmm.
The gorilla. I think it's awesome. Tell us more about Chi-raq Rilla, because I've heard you've mentioned it a little bit
mm-hmm
this season, but tell us about Chi-raq Rilla.
This is actually the brand I'm wearing right now. Chi-raq Rilla was started from a good friend of mine. His name is Chi-raq. And it was started as a workout brand.
Mm-hmm.
And I came in, saw what he was doing with the brand, and I thought mm-hmm I could take it to new heights, and I did.
Nice.
It's really a captivating brand. It's come straight out of Chi-raq, and the meaning behind the brand is Chi-raq is a rough city to grow up in. It's almost
mm-hmm
like a jungle,
mm-hmm,
and the gorilla is one of the most dominant animals in the jungle.
Yes.
Growing up, like, Chi-raq is our concrete jungle,
mm-hmm,
and the gorilla, you know, the similarities to a man,
mm-hmm,
a black man in Chi-raq mm is very, very similar. Having
right
to run from the police, mm, still be able to, you know, having to take care of our young, just like the,
right,
you know, the gorilla does in the jungle. You know, have to
right
take care of his young and have to, you know, move diligently. And it's
right
like, it's the similarities is just so you know, so complex, and it's right there.
That's dope. I seen that you had your first opening like a few weeks ago for Chicago Rilla. How did that go?
We sold out of all of our custom merchandise.
Ooh, because congratulations.
Yes, it's a custom brand. Every piece is definitely custom. I'll make it right there on the spot for you.
Nice.
And
it's amazing how it's all come full circle for you. Now you're designing, and that's how you started.
Right.
That's awesome.
Right. It was a really nice turnout.
So tell us what's up next for you. Like, what should we be on the lookout for?
Definitely be on the lookout for the brand, you know, growing to, you know, immensely, and just look out for me and the rest of the season. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Maybe some truth and light will be shedding on to my story and what's the outcome of that.
Yes.
But if not, just be on the lookout for me, because I was always a guy that was kind of like in the back. You know what I'm saying? I wasn't brought to the forefront.
Mm-hmm.
And I wasn't brought to the forefront until I started, you know what I'm saying, making some affirmative actions.
Yes. Right. And that's what you have to do.
That's what you have to
get your respect.
Yeah, I love. Exactly.
Yes.
So I'm here.
Check out Van. I'm happy that you came and you clarified some things and we talked, because, you know, watching the show, I'm like, what the fuck is going on in episode? We're only three episodes deep.
I've had to deal with so many goddamn hecklers. And
that's
not your shot. It's not. Only thing y'all saying is that's not your shot. But if you don't know, then I really can't fault you.
That's
what
I've been saying. Right. I'm like, something doesn't add up, and I can feel it. Like, there's a key that we're missing here, and you came and you gave it today. So we want to thank you so much
for
coming in.
You got to come back and kick it with us, because from the previews, I see there's a lot more craziness happening.
Yes.
You got 18 episodes.
You have to come back and review an episode with us so we can talk about all the fun and drama while it's happening.
Let's do it.
That's amazing. Tell everybody where they can find Chicago Rilla, where they can find you at, and where they can get your merchandise from.
Chicago Rilla, you can find that at chicagorilla.com. You can find me on Instagram, Van Tats No Excuses. That's VanTatsNoExcuses. And you can also find me on Snapchat, VanTatz, Van Tats.
All right. Nice. Well, thank you very much for your time, Van. We hope that you enjoy your weekend in Los Angeles, and you have a great time.
Yeah, my foot hurting, but
because it's hot.
And until next time, I am your girl, Carmen Cameron, and you can find me on Instagram at Carmen Cameron.
And I am your girl, Nakia Monet, and you can find me on all social media at Kiki Boom Boom.
Yes, and we will see you for next week's episode review of Black Ink Crew Chicago. We'll be here, so make sure you tune in.
It's going to be a wild run.
Yes, it's going to be a wild one, so tune in.
Peace.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.